Well, there are quite a number of dedications among the Chopin waltzes, but from what you say, I imagine these salutes had a practical value. There's only one that bears the name of his great amour, George Sand.
But then there's another waltz which is very, very sentimental, which he has written officially as a love token to his unfortunately not realized fiancée. And I mean, he didn't marry her because the parents were against that marriage, but he did propose marriage to the young Countess Wodzinska. And that waltz, he was titling to Miss to Mademoiselle Marie. That means, and there's all his love in it. You can trace it, you can feel it. So when I play it, of course, I can't miss, but thinking of Marie Wodzinska, of the sad story, why he didn't get her, and he left a little bundle of her letters with the inscription on it, my unhappiness, my pains. In Polish, it's another word. My poor, I don't know, my unhappiness, let's say. Never mind, it's not the exact word.
You have established the story so well, Mr. Rubinstein. I've been wondering if perhaps albums like this new one, in which you perform so magnificently, might not be making life difficult for rising young pianists. Recordings are so widely disseminated today, people come to expect a certain level of performance which the younger ones do not yet achieve, which is perhaps why the field is so small.
I must say it's quite the contrary, if I may say so. In old times, the young pianists had a very, very hard time because they had no means of publicizing themselves. After all, this business of radio and of television and of gramophone records above all, I mean mostly gramophone records, gives them a tremendous chance of being heard.
I guess it does get them exposure in the United States, which they couldn't any other way.
Look here, America was always a very difficult country, very inaccessible in a way, because they were always conscious of the money possibilities in America, so they defended their ground. It was not easy for a European artist to reach America with a good contract and make money here. It had to be, says somebody, after he's reached the fame, you know that very well, in old times. Well, now, for instance, if a good manager or a good publicizer of gramophone records can bring two or three decent records from somewhere, from Vienna, from Berlin, from any country across, and make a good publicity for it, he becomes suddenly famous overnight.
Well, which comes first, the chicken or the egg? Fame in concert and then a recording contract? Or fame on records and then a concert tour?
That depends, both ways. It has happened this way and the other way.
How about in your own particular case? Of course, you started quite young.
Well, in my case, I must tell you my own case. In old times, I mean my very young, first youth, I mean my 20 years, you know. Well, that was a very hard time for pianists.
Oh, why was that, Mr. Rubinstein?
First of all, we were committed to a season. The season ran from October till April. From April till October, the seasons were dead. We were out of work completely. We had nothing in the world to earn money because all the families who took lessons went to the sea or the mountains or the country or I don't know what for vacations for months to go. There were no concerts because it's too warm. Nobody would dream of going to a concert hall. There was nothing. Cheap summer concerts in parks or something like that with little bands. I mean, music was completely stopped in April till October. I remember very well that time because we were all dreaming to be invited by a nice family to spend the summer in the country place, you know, to be treated to that and so on, otherwise we would starve. That goes for Chopin too, you know, when he went to the lovely estate of Georges Sand. It was probably great love and attachment to her, but at the same time, he spent his summer without starving because there were no lessons and there was nothing for him to do.
I think maybe you're being a little unromantic about the great affair, but you think that nowadays Chopin would have had less to worry about than bed and board for the summer?
Nowadays, the thing is completely different because, as you see, that every second day there's a festival of music, and they are catering for it like mad, and they grow up like mushrooms. There are pianist competitions. There are about, I think now, 2 dozen of them in all of the world, and there are no pianists left to take part in them because the best have won already. There are special mothers, you know, being taken care of, you know, to produce the pianists of the next generation for the competitions.
You know, I was wondering how you feel about such things, competitions for artists.
Well, I'm a little bit against it. I think a competition should be a very rare event. Sometimes it can do any good to a pianist, but in very rare cases. Most winners of competitions never go very far. It's an exception. You see, von Kleiben struck the jackpot in Moscow, and he deserved it. That's quite all right, that's fine. Those cases have been once or twice justified. But most of the winners fall into complete obscurity.
But from what I've heard, this sudden oblivion isn't just a question of talent. We know that the politics of the concert field is very important. It's as important to have the right manager as it is to practice the 48 preludes and fugues.
Well, the answer is always the box office. The same thing with books, the same thing with paintings, with everything. What is bought, what is in demand, is the winner. The manager doesn't like to lose his money with a genius for whom he has the deepest respect, but who doesn't make any money. But he will cater very much for a rather lesser fellow who is a colossal attraction to the public. Don't you think so? It is so. It's always been that way.
Yes, I'm afraid you're probably right, Mr. Rubinstein. In your case, we have the happy combination of both factors. I see by the album cover that this was done abroad, Mr. Rubinstein.
It is a very amusing thing. We recorded it in Rome, and I had 2 pianos in the company. The Victor Company was very generous about it, and they had 2 pianos come, one from Naples and one from Florence, because I had used them previously and I loved them. So on my insistence, they got them for me, and they were standing there in that wonderful brand new studio they have built near Rome. And the best studio in the world, by the way, for recording. All the big operas of the day are made there and so on. Well, I was very happy to go to it, and I had the assignment to make those waltzes for the Dinah Grove, for the modern development and so on. Very happily, what did I find? Both those pianos were in such a shape that they were absolutely impossible to be used. You know. Two tuners came, one specially from Florence, who said that he's the only one entitled to use that piano, to work on that piano, and he was no good. He just put it more out of tune than it was before. I mean, I worked hard on 2 or 3 waltzes for 4 days, I think, and no work could come out of it. I mean, they were tuning, it was worse, it sounded dreadfully. I couldn't make it. My technique was not adequate. Nothing came off of it and so on. And then my wife had the great idea, seeing my despair after all, to telephone a brilliant, wonderful tuner which we have in Paris. A young boy, a young man, was very keen to come to Rome for the first time in his life to see the Eternal City. So he came right away next morning. Being a very conscientious fellow, he went, before he even looked around Rome, he went to those 2 pianos, worked them up, and that same night I finished all 14 waltzes in one single session. And the studio was available for me only after a huge, huge session of the opera. I think it was Rigoletto for the Victor Company. I started at 7 in the evening and worked till midnight, and they were all finished.
That's incredible. One straight recording session for all the waltzes?
I never forget that. It was really an inspired session.
And I don't imagine any of the others present will forget it either. When you're all alone with the technicians in a recording studio, Mr. Rubinstein, do you find the lack of an audience makes it difficult for you to work yourself up to performing pitch?
Oh, no. I love recording. I must say, I love recording without an audience. Just it is something, it's a fight with myself. I will not stop a recording unless I feel that I cannot do better for the moment. But if there is the slightest chance to improve on something, I will never give in. I could work 24 hours in succession. I'm the one who never gets tired, never.
This is your reputation. I understand you work engineers and technicians until they're run ragged.
I could bring everybody to his grave, you know, but I'm not tired when it comes to working a record or do something in a movie or something. I mean, a thing like that, undertake an artistic assignment.
I understand that after you recorded this new collection of Chopin waltzes, you didn't even quit after doing the whole thing in one session. You went out and staged a party afterwards.
Not a party. We tried to get drunk on Via Veneto in Rome, but we couldn't succeed because we are very resistant. But just with my friend Wilcox, who helped in doing those records, and my wife and my son, we just went to a cafe and had it till 4 in the morning.
There must be some sort of secret for your vitality, something you ought to share. What do you do, for instance, immediately before you play a concert? You seem to arrive on the stage so relaxed, so at ease. You approach your instrument in such a straightforward way. You immediately command the attention of your audience.
It is even dangerous to touch that subject because you might make me self-conscious. This is a thing which I never could understand what it consists of, where the focus is. I've been called sometimes by critics this great showman, meaning exactly what you just said so flatteringly and so nicely. They said, oh, the great showman in this natural way, he comes up with a quick pace to the piano, sits down upright on the stool and all that of thing. Well, I did that when I was 8 years old and 10 years old. I always run like that in the street. I hate to walk with my wife because she makes a smaller pace, you know. I mean, she has another step than I. I like to walk quickly. You know, I mean, it is the most natural thing in the world. I always behave that same way, and there's nothing which I add or plan or do about it. I have no idea of what that consists. I hear lately very much about it, that, oh, the minute you come up and you bow, the public is with you. Well, I will not and cannot understand that. I try to behave quite naturally. I bow seriously to the audience. I don't smile stupidly, you know, to catch their sympathy or something. I do smile when they applaud me very heartily. Well, I would be very ill-bred if I didn't, wouldn't I?
Quite frankly, Mr. Rubinstein, I can't think of any word that applies less. Someone once said that Arthur Rubinstein is the last civilized man, and after having had this chance to share a conversation with him, I would agree most heartily.